Hello and welcome to this Newsclick year-end sports special. And because it's a festive season, I've got with me two guys in studio who you can roll into one great big cuddly Santa Claus. Vaibhav Raghunandan and Leslie Xavier.
Merry Christmas. Ho, ho, ho.
Yes. Okay, please only invite these guys to be Santa Claus at adults' parties. Okay, but on that jovial, jolly note, it's been an exciting, a very busy sporting year. The Asian Games, Commonwealth Games, the Football World Cup, a lot of the Hockey World Cup, a lot of action this year. So how we're going to do this is basically we'll, all three of us, the Newsclick sports team, will discuss a couple of sports stories that were the closest in your mind to the kind of sports journalism that you guys started in your careers wanting to do. The most exciting, interesting, endearing, sad, whatever it might be, right? So let me come to you first, Leslie.
I'll start with the latest, actually, the one that the big tournament that got over in Bhubaneswar, the Hockey World Cup. We were looking beyond the stadium. We were looking at how the tournament is touching lives, not just of the players who are involved in it or the officials or the immediate organizing fraternity, but about the volunteers, the boys and girls who were there from the villages, from the academies around Orissa, who were definitely left inspired by the tournament and seeing all these players in action. Mm. About the businesses that flourishes around this thing. I'm not talking about the major sponsors as such. By the way, Odisha State was the sponsor of the World Cup. That's something new. Otherwise, the flag sellers, the jersey sellers, the face painters, all these things.
Yeah, micro. That develops around the stadium.
So, exactly. And obviously, the stories related to the World Cup as such, how India fared, what the World Cup means for Indian hockey. There were a few good written pieces as well, how Indian Hockey India treats its players badly, for instance, and also where the sport is heading, that was written by Vaibhav, where the sport is heading and, I mean, how relevant will hockey be in the next 10 years, for instance. So, these are the kind of stories we tried to address, and Belgium has announced itself onto the world stage. That is something that Vaibhav felt very close about, the story of Belgium. So maybe you can shed some
light. Yeah, I mean, it's just, I find it really endearing, Belgium story, simply because they started their hockey journey at the same time that Indian hockey got a reality check. 2008 Beijing Olympics, Belgium qualified for the Olympics, India did not. Belgium qualified and said, hey, you know what, we want to win gold two editions later. India did not, and India said, hey, you know what? We want to win gold two editions later. But look who did. Look who went that way and managed to put their systems in place. So, in fact, one of the things that really came across to me when talking to people at the World Cup was where Indian hockey focuses on developing good, making a good team for a tournament. Belgian hockey wants to make a good team for the future. So they're not training players for a World Cup, a Champions Trophy, a World League, or an Olympics. They're training coaches and players who will carry the game forward for as long as you can play it.
I think if you have to go way back, it's in 2008, the team qualified for the Beijing Olympics. First time in 32 years, I think. And that's when it all started. The funding became the young, the under 16, under 18, under 21 teams. We got good coaches, we got good training camps, and you see that from a young age. We started to get the right training, and the guys who are now in this team, we played under 18s, under 21s, and we won medals. And you can feel that since 2008, 2009, we started just growing, and this team has been together since, I think, 2012, 2013, and you see that now we're growing so fast, and it's not over, I think.
That picture is what we tried to provide while covering it for Newsclick, that the sport of hockey and where Indian hockey stand as far as the global game is concerned, and how the approach is, I mean, it's not right on many counts, because ultimately, it's not about the results, like he mentioned. Ultimately, it's not about a generation or two generation of players. Ultimately, it's about setting up a framework for something which the game becomes self-sustaining in the country, and the talent keeps on coming into the system organically.
And that's actually the problem with Indian sport as a whole. Like, there is no like way where you constantly are trying to churn out players. There is a system in place. Like, take kabaddi, for example. For years and years, we've had great kabaddi players who have won us medals at the top echelons of the sport. But evidently, there have been problems at the grassroots level, at the administrative level.
And this year, with India losing gold at the Asian Games to Iran, that
the can of worms.
Sort of, yeah, that Pandora's box opened up. Which leads us, I think, quite seamlessly into the next story, which is the sport of kabaddi, and a sport that's domestically doing really well because of the introduction of the Pro Kabaddi League. So in terms of popularity, its popularity is growing. Players are being able to now earn a pretty decent living out of playing the sport professionally. But below the surface, problems it's everywhere.
It's pretty cancerous if I use that word, because success on the international stage for the national team is actually very paramount for its popularity, and it's, I mean, we take pride saying that kabaddi we are unbeaten, not anymore. And Iran is very close actually, and it's not like it was a one-off victory or something like that. And there, and then when we Newsclick tried to dwell deeper into the reason why India lost, that's when the can of worms opened. So in the last 3-4 years, there have been court cases and all that, because at the federation level, there was monopoly of one particular family, Gehlot family, and they were controlling kabaddi, and they were putting their people on all the state associations, and then obviously nepotism and its various versions came up. And this particular Asian Games teams, that the two teams that went to the Asian Games, apparently there were a lot of corruption. Allegation was their court cases were filed, and what the court decided was to conduct a trial, because it was too late, they decided to conduct a trial or something on that lines. After
the Asian Games trials after the Asian after, Games.
No, but then it later turned out that the court didn't mean trial, so there was a problem with that. So it was quite a messy affair, and we were at the ground where these trials were supposed to happen. It was at the IG Stadium in New Delhi.
अभी आज के मैचेस, otherwise तो कोई interpretation उसका क्यों ले सकता है, unless कि उनका कोई और देश नहीं हो. आज कोई हम किसी अपकमिंग इवेंट के लिए कोई टीम नहीं सिलेक्ट कर रहे
हैं। हाँ, ये क्या हो रहा है? ऐसे ये टीमें खेल रही हैं, क्या चल रहा है ये? ये
अभी क्या? अकॉर्डिंग टू अस, ये सिर्फ एक आईवाश है।
आईवाश है, ड्रामा चल रहा
है। ये सिर्फ ड्रामा है।
जो लोग जिनसे खेलना था, जिसके लिए खेलना था, जिनको टेस्ट करना था, जो एलिगेशन था सुप्रीम कोर्ट में, हाई कोर्ट में, यदि वो नहीं आए तो दूसरे ऐसे मतलब मान लिया 1,00,000 लोग बुला के हम फाइल कर नहीं. मैच अल्टीमेटली मैं क्या कह रहा हूँ, इसका कोई इस ऑर्डर के हिसाब से इसका कोई रिलेवेंस नहीं.
देयर वर अ सेट ऑफ प्लेयर्स हु हैड कम इन from the brought in by the guys who filed the original case, and they happen to be the new Kabaddi Federation of India, NKFI, that's the name by the way, new kabaddi, and they are trying something new for the sport, they claim. And so the players were there, the selections never didn't happen, the national teams were not, I mean obviously they interpreted the court's decision saying that it was not a straight on selection trial or a match between those teams, and that which anyways would have been meaningless. But there was a lot of confusion, and these players went back, media buzz was there. And then what happens, the new Kabaddi Federation launches a league of its own. So it's basically meant for players who are not part of the existing Pro League. And it's supposed to actually be a rival to the Pro League. Here what is happening is that two federations would be fighting each other, and then two leagues will come up. So the a set of players would be barred from by the other federation. Court cases will happen. National team again will go to the stage that it was, state that it was before the Asian Games. And so where does the sport head?
The pattern that emerges from across all the stories that we've covered in all the various disciplines seems to be that at the top, the people who are determining the structure, there's a lot of politics, corruption, money exchanging hands, favoritism, lack of transparency. But then you go to the grassroots level where sport in a way is being played in its purest form,
yeah.
where usually younger athletes, boys, girls, are playing a sport that they love, mm-hmm. being trained by a coach who often doesn't take any money for the training he or she is imparting, and has set up very basic kind of infrastructure where these kids who otherwise have no real outlet for their energy except going to school and then the usual forms of entertainment, electronic media, etc., etc. Right? So, is that, would you agree that across all sports, it seems to be a pretty similar story that at the grassroots, the intentions are good. The desire to be engaged with sport is for those reasons. Of course, athletes that are getting involved also want opportunities. I mean, if they excel, then they would like support from the system to encourage them further, sure. But when they're starting off, things are pretty decent.
So that
or
is
at least encouraging.
That is not just true for sport. I would say like that's true for any form of human endeavor. At the smallest level, it's always noble and very genuine and very nice to see. And as soon as there's a little bit of money involved,
so it's not just money. Yeah. So the thing is that at the smallest level, at the grassroots level, and we all have been there as a journalist, as part of the system, playing the sport. So their athletes themselves play for the right reason, and the organizers and the coaches and the system around them also do the things for the right reason, which is for the sport itself. Mm. And then as it goes up, athletes remain true to that reason because they want glory, they want a career out of it, which is nothing wrong in it. Money.
Yeah, exactly. Reason for the athlete also evolves, yeah. but it does not it evolve does not at the corruption of their sporting values.
Exactly. But
and inherently, their success is also linked to
what their desire is.
Exactly. So they remain true to the core values of sport that way. But the people who change are the administrators, and that you can't. I mean, and it's not a.
So as a case in point, let's bring up the story of Satnam Singh, who was celebrated a couple of years ago as the first Indian to be picked in the NBA draft by the Dallas Mavericks. Second round pick, 52nd overall. But a moment that was like sort of heralded as the coming of age or the Indian basketball becoming the next big thing, competing to be the number two viewed sport in the country. And then a year after that, we found Satnam
back home.
Back in his village, really frustrated, upset, and alone, feeling quite alone.
This was like a perfect example of what happens when you herald a guy as the new champion of, like, I mean, these are the kind of stories that movies are made out of, you know, but in reverse. You know, it's a nothing guy going and becoming a real big guy.
So they're lucky. The bright side is that Satnam's journey was not over. So yeah. We met him. He was obviously training. He got a contract with the Canadian League. He's gone abroad again. He will play. He will hopefully come up. But this takes us back to that systemic problem that you mentioned.
That's the same.
Yeah, exactly.
When you find the guy and when you're trying to build him up into this marketable, PR-able kind of commodity, then he is the best thing ever.
Exactly.
And then once he fails.
The minute you realize that he's really not as good as you thought he would be just because he's 7'2", for example, in this case.
Yeah.
Because you are competing with other big guys as well, right?
7'2", agile and...
You drop him like a hot potato. Yeah.
The system just does not make a place for failure and does not give you an option.
No, this was actually the problem was that they just jumped into it because it was selfish on the part of Satnam's promoters. NBA India or the NBA mechanism or the Mavericks themselves. Because they all are looking into India as a market. They are not looking into India as a place where you develop talent and bring Indian basketball up. India is an untapped market for NBA, for any clubs for that matter. That's why in football, a lot of academies are established here who hardly churn out players who would go to Europe to play, things like that. But Satnam's case, they portrayed him as a big thing, and it was to a large extent fake because he was never seasoned for that. And these these NBA players, they go through that collegiate system, high school system and collegiate system, which is highly competitive. The NCAA system is slightly below NBA, probably in physicality and all that. But otherwise, as far as game skill is involved, the game time, the way the athletes live about their life, everything is based on that model the athlete would be living when he becomes a professional athlete.
Actually, I must also point out,
hopefully also receiving a college education.
Yeah.
I just want to point this out also, that we are like sitting and talking about how like Satnam's career has gone downhill, this and that. But he's what, 24?
No, younger.
Oh, yeah.
Younger. He's, I think, 22 or so.
That's why I started this.
As old as our camera operator.
Yeah.
Wow.
So that's why he's in Canada and awfully from, because he has had experience playing in the D League in the NBA and going through the paces, and he understands what to expect. And Canadian League is slightly lesser than NBA, but competitive nonetheless. And from there, he can come up. He can probably enter NBA the right way, the way it was meant to be. Develop and take step by step and all that. And you don't need any kind of an next big thing promotion around him to actually unnecessarily put pressure on him. And I'm sure when you entered his house, he would have felt that sickening feeling that you feel when the athlete is feeling lost.
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, and it's a all other things aside, it's a great thing that this kid now has the chance to go back and play fairly competitive basketball on a regular basis. If nothing else, I mean, literally when he was sitting with us, all he was asking was for someone to realize that he's there in Ballu Ke village near Ludhiana, and he's been trained in the sport of basketball for several years. He does or knows how to do very little else. And he was hoping that someone would use these skills that he has to offer, the service that he has to provide. And hopefully St. John's Edge, which is the team that he's playing for in Canada, will find some utility for him and he'll be able to craft a career. So the positive was that this guy at least got a second chance.
Yeah.
Right? Which now brings me to my sport and what is happening in the I-League. We had great stories. We started the year with
new champions,
yeah, a brand new second year club that was almost out of the I-League, that went through in the season. It went through match fixing, players getting attracted by bigger clubs, new players coming and going, but yet managed to do a Leicester City and beat the Mohun Bagans and the East Bengals and everyone else that was, and Aizawl FC and the upcoming teams, to actually repeat what Aizawl had done the previous year.
You know, Aizawl was an underdog story. I think Minerva has been a Bollywood dhamaka story.
So, 2 years in a row, you had this fantastic sort of dramatic nail-biting, or not, maybe not nail-biting, but last match day finish, where an unexpected club that's come from the ground up is taking the league. And we find ourselves now in a situation that we've been talking about for so long, for 8 years, where from the inside, the All India Football Federation's commercial partners are not only trying to sabotage but completely destroy this league to ensure that in the years going forward, anyone serious about coming into Indian football from the perspective of creating a club and playing at the highest level would go to the Indian Super League.
The fate would be decided by the backers, financial backers, like you mentioned.
You mean to say they don't want two leagues?
So the entire structure seems now to be driven based on an ownership model where the football federation or the clubs, even the clubs themselves, have no ownership on the competition at large. But the competition is being owned and governed and managed by certain partner entities who are putting up the money. And basically, they get to decide what happens with this sport. Now, what we are all hoping for is that football is known as the people's sport or is a popular sport for a reason. And that these clubs, some of whom have hundreds of years of history, will not take it lying down.
More than the clubs that have hundreds of years of history, they'll probably get off
by joining the
Cheap shot.
Yeah.
But what really hurts about killing the I-League is that you won't get stories like Aizawl. You won't get stories like Naroka also last season. And you'll definitely not get a story like Real Kashmir. You know, you'll never have a Real Kashmir playing in ISL because there is no one who
there's
is
no
in,
one
Kashmir
in Kashmir
who,
who's willing
because
to
Arjun Kapoor will not go and
guarantee.
Buy a club there. Sorry, he won't. Yeah. It's just true. He'd rather buy a club wherever, Pune.
Yeah.
And so that completely changes the dynamic of a football competition.
And also, if you look at stadium attendance, ISL is no match for I-League.
Not what they have you believe on.
No,
on
yeah,
there.
I mean...
When you watch it on television.
They have first season footage.
I mean, for people who've seen...
No, the thing is, Gokulam, Kerala, for instance, in Kozhikode, the municipal stadium, they had close to 60,000 attendance last month in one of their home matches.
I mean, you've been to Naroka Stadium. You've been there for several games. It's almost always got at least 50% attendance.
Yeah.
Kashmir's first home game was something out of...
They have to lock the gates before the match so that more people don't...
Absolutely.
And Kolkata, people don't care about
Meanwhile, Delhi are playing in the ISL.
Yeah. Which stadium?
I don't know.
Well, as far as the Football Federation here is concerned, and the man running it is concerned, it's a very clear case of dismantling as many parts as possible and selling it to his friends and family. It's a straight up, I mean, there is no discussion, there's nothing further to it in this.
Apparently, the man running the show believes that we will qualify for the 2026 World
Cup. Qualify? We're going to win it.
No, winning was Asian Cup. We're going to win the Asian Cup.
What? Your dreams are too little.
This is what happens when we start talking football. Yeah. It ends up going from a 15-minute show to a half hour very, very quickly. So, we'll curtail it at that. I think the general sentiment, like guys, to sum up your feelings from 2018, Webber, your year covering sport and what you hope for in 2019?
I think some of the stories that I most enjoyed doing were related to grassroots sport, were related to sport that is usually ignored by mainstream sport. And that is perhaps the least depressing way to cover Indian sport.
Things like that, the beauty of sport. So capturing that actually gives us a more wholesome experience than going to an ISL venue. In India, the problem is that the way things are heading, and there's nothing wrong in commercializing. It's good for players, it's good for the sport.
It has to be done.
But it is not being done the right way because the vested interest, the control that is being done, it's actually killing the charm of mainstream sport too. Because it's killing sports for the fans, it's killing sport for the players. It has definitely killed sport for the journalists who are covering it.
And on this great positive note.
No, there are a lot of positives
for
2019.
Happy New Year!
Let's hope that the Indian team does well at the AFC Cup.
Yeah, no.
The first
so, the reason why we are so jovial, even though we are supposedly discussing morose or serious sort of stories that are typical of an Indian context, 2019 is another year. It's a chance for not just football, but for several other sports to realize that there is a possibility for people to make money, even if you don't cheat everyone else out of it. That perhaps if we establish a platform or systems or processes that are more equal, then many more can perhaps in the long term benefit from it. Yeah. Whether or not Indian sport will do this, we'll let you know in 2019, because despite what people want, we're not going anywhere. So have a great end to 2018 and see you again next year.